But there will be no elections. This is the beginning of Castro's democracy by acclamation, the shouting response of a hand-picked mob agreeing with the proposals of the dictator. He stands this night at Camp Columbia with his generals, the bearded anti-communist Camilo Cienfuegos. Cienfuegos, once a Miami handyman and a New York dishwasher, will disappear, reportedly gunned down by Raul Castro's pilot while flying back to Havana after a fight with Raul. The celebration goes on. These are not politically minded people. They fought for the simple things, for some degree of human dignity, for the right to work and eat and to speak without fear and to go to church and to have a say about who is to govern them. If they had only known that Castro promised these rights for every Cuban to further his personal lust for power, how could they know he would allow the Russians to steal their revolution? If Batista was like Hitler, truly Castro will prove to be like Stalin. The unfortunate people of Cuba will discover that they have been betrayed. The time will come when many of these same simple people, now wildly cheering Fidel Castro, will be fighting again to rid themselves of this new tyrant. Just 90 miles away, Miami feels the backwash of the revolution as refugees stream in to avoid the firing squads. Batista goes to the Dominican Republic. One of those who gets out by the skin of his teeth is Batista's son. But waiting for him is an anti-Batista Cuban who wants to get in some licks of his own. They have a pitched battle at a Florida airport. A gun is found later, but it was not used. The 26th of July movement holds meetings all over Havana, and almost always Celia Sanchez takes her place near Castro. Known as a dedicated communist sympathizer, she now holds an important spot as private secretary to him. For safety, he travels about by tank. 3 weeks after Batista's fall, Castro promptly accepts an invitation from Venezuela to visit that country. From the airport, Castro rides through cheering crowds who hail him as the Cuban liberator. These are not communist crowds, but plain people who have just gotten the dictator off their own backs. The people of Venezuela contributed money to the Cuban Revolution. Little do they know that within a matter of months, Castro will be using the Cuban embassy to help the local Venezuelan communists to conspire against their government. At the university, Castro receives an honorary degree. Even in New York's Central Park, Castro receives a public reception as liberator of the Cuban people. Few doubt his sincerity. Few know what he plans to do next. Back in Cuba, Castro's executions form a chapter by themselves. They began during Castro's march into Havana and gave his new government a potent weapon, terror. The first trials were based on evidence of Batista brutality, but they will soon be held for those who disagree with Castro. Implements of torture are put into evidence, tools to tear back the fingernails and perform even more brutal forms of torture. Some cannot be shown. But the speed of the trials makes the world wonder if there may not be some innocent victims. Crowds jam the courtroom to see the war criminals hauled before the bar of revolutionary justice. Scores of such trials send 600 men before the firing squads until the world cries out for Castro to stop this mass murder. It's a gripping scene when Colonel Cornelio Rojas, Batista's commander at Pina del Rio, strides to his death as though on parade. The orders are read, farewells are spoken, last-minute instructions are given. The verdict of revolutionary justice is to be spoken in the language of finality. Thus speaks Castro justice. Each new trial is a carbon copy of the one before, The charges read, the accusation made, the finger pointed, and the verdict rendered. There is little point in attempting a defense. The result is a foregone conclusion, as at this trial of Lieutenant D'Espagne. Castro cannot understand the avalanche of criticism. After all, he says, there are trials. Batista never gave any of the people a trial, he shouts angrily. We are executing murderers, and they deserve to be shot. Convicted by the fast-moving revolutionary justice, Lieutenant D'Espagne's appeal was heard and denied the same day. The death sentence stands. He writes a note to his wife and son, then asks permission to give the order to fire himself. There is no appeal from death. No pleas from the outside world could stop the trials. The people get their revolutionary justice. While world attention is focused on the executions, the Communist Party takes over Cuba step by step. Antonio Nunez Jimenez takes charge of the Agrarian Reform Institute with plans to run the entire Cuban economy. Fidel Castro nods assent and signs the decrees. Jimenez leads the peasants to believe that they are getting the 66 acres which they were promised. There are joyful demonstrations in anticipation of this great event. They are in for a rude shock when the few who do get deeds discover that the deeds provide that they occupy the land, work for the state, and cannot sell the land. The long-range plan laid by Jimenez and his Marxist friend Che Guevara is to take over everything. They are joined by Osvaldo Torticos Dorado, who became president when Castro ousted President Urrutia for disagreeing with the leftist trend of the government. The red ties are plain to see when a Russian airliner sets down in Cuba with the Soviet Union's hard-nosed traitor, Anastas Mikoyan. The crowds hear that Mikoyan has come to offer help. Mikoyan knows the Kremlin has a big stake in Cuba and is here to talk business. President Osvaldo Torticos greets the Soviet traveler, and no time is wasted. They agree that Russia will immediately extend full diplomatic recognition to the revolutionary government, and the Reds will reopen an embassy in Havana. At a party, Guevara makes snapshots of the Russian visitor, who has gone native. Castro tells Mikoyan of his plan to expand the Fidelista revolution to all of Latin America. Mikoyan suggests using Cuban diplomatic pouches to spread subversion. He smacks his lips at the prospect of getting a base from which to spread communism to all of Latin America. Castro hears that the Reds will supply oil, buy Cuban sugar, send him technicians, supply him with more Soviet planes and arms. It isn't long before the new tactics are pursued by the National Institute for Agrarian Reform. While Mikoyan is still in Cuba, Che Guevara tells him the revolution has taken over 51% of the land. Through Castro's INRA, the government owns cane fields, the plantations, pasture land. And the guajiros, the workers who were promised the land, find themselves captives of the state. Cooperatives, as in Russia and Red China, pay the workers in scrip, good only in the collective stores. Fidel Castro's INRA operates out of a 19-story headquarters in Havana and gobbles up businesses and industries in a wide-sweeping takeover of all means of production. He even asks children to report on parents who disagree with his plans. Castro puts himself in the construction business and builds model homes for workers. Much of what is done is window dressing. These houses look good. Few got them. The housing pinch is even more serious because the workers' pay goes down and taxes go up. This East Havana housing project is never finished. The people and the wealth of Cuba are fast becoming the property of Boss Castro, and Castro is becoming the property of the Kremlin. To provide a new military force he can control, Castro organizes a vast civilian militia. There's a woman's militia, student militia, and workers must join the militia to hold jobs. Castro buys arms from abroad. In March 1960, a French ship loaded with Belgian arms catches on fire in Havana Harbor. Suddenly, havoc. Smoke billows around the helicopter on which Castro himself is surveying the scene. Close to 100 men are mangled in the series of explosions. 200 are hurt. The blasts take a frightful toll. The heart of the world is touched by this shocking tragedy. But to the utter surprise of most Americans, Castro seizes upon this emotion-packed moment to launch a savage attack upon the United States. Castro says the ship has been blown up by United States agents. The lie is spread all over the world. There has never been a retraction. It is now apparent that Castro will stop at nothing to gain support for the communist-inspired Hate America campaign.